Good evening. Welcome to worship. I'm Pastor Sheely. We'll open our service tonight as we break free from our bonds, break out of prison, break down some doors. We're going to be getting some brokenness from sin and release from our bondage today, as we see Jesus is our ultimate gate breaker tonight. All right, we will open though with our first song, hymn 427, In the Cross of Christ I Glory, verses 1 through 3. Worship is found for you printed in the bulletin. We begin with the invocation on page 3. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
We now join together in saying responsively Psalm 51 as a confession of our sins. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions.
Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me.
Against you, you only have I sinned and have done what is evil in your sight, so that you are ordered right when you see and justify when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me.
Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the inmost place.
Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquity.
Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
You do not delight in sacrifice, for I will bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings.
The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise.
And so we come to you, O God, with broken spirits and contrite hearts. Trust you only in the merits of Jesus, who cleanses, heals, and forgives us.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, proclaim the grace of God to all of you, and in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sin. I forgive you and give you the full and complete freedom for all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We now join together in singing hymn 427, verse 4. Please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Almighty God, merciful Father, you opened a way for your ancient people Israel to return from Babylon to the promised land. And through your Son Jesus, you open up for us the way to everlasting life. Free us from the chains that bind us so that we follow where you lead all the days of our life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the readings.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Old Testament reading
is from Isaiah chapter 45, verses 1 through 8. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him and to loose the belts of kings, to open doors before him,
that gates may not be closed. I will go before you and level the exalted places. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and the hoards in secret places, that you may know it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name. For the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel, my chosen, I call you by your name. I name you though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I equip you, though you do not know me, that people may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make well-being and create calamity. I am the Lord who does all these things. Shower, O heavens, from above, and let the clouds rain down righteousness. Let the earth open, that salvation and righteousness may bear fruit. Let the earth cause them both to sprout. I, the Lord, have created it. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
We have a children's message now. And so can I have the kids come forward? That's okay. She can stay asleep. Hi. All right, so I need a volunteer. No, we'll do Isaac. All right, come on. So you stand right here. Stand right here. Okay, and I need you to hold still for a second. All right, so can you describe for the people who can't see what I am doing right now?
You're locking up my feet.
You're going to go a little tighter.
If he can't walk, and if he does, he will probably face
a cliff.
Okay. Get this back here, really get it tight. There we go. No, here. I just got to do this a better way. Okay, there we go. All right, I'll just toss that over there. Okay, so what do you think? Is it real easy to move?
No.
All right, let's play tag, okay? You're it, and I need you to go tag Faith. You can't do it, can you? All right, stop. Come back. So I've got a question. Is that the best way to go about and to try to accomplish things?
No.
No? What happens if I were to just kind of toss you like that? Do you think you'd fall over?
I almost did.
Oh, yeah. So what do you guys think? Should I unlock him?
Yes.
No.
Yeah? Okay.
That's the wrong key.
It is.
Why would there be two keys on the floor? That's what I want to know. Although I am having trouble unlocking it.
See? It's wrong key. Oh, no. Oh, no.
Why is it?
Let me
it's not. It's not the wrong key. We only had one key. I am actually having trouble right now. Yeah, go ahead and sit down. Well, that is quite a conundrum. There isn't two keys. There it goes. I don't know. That was weird. I honestly don't know what happened there. No. Okay. So go ahead and sit down here. So sit. So I've got a question. What was the thing that allowed you to get free?
The key that almost didn't work.
God. Yeah, the key that, well, in this case, almost didn't work.
God.
The key, God. Yes. And when we are bound up by the bad things we do, it's kind of like we're chained. It's kind of like we can't actually, Levi, shh. It's kind of like we can't accomplish what God wants us to do, which is to love each other, to be kind to each other. And, you know, God throughout history has sent people, whether it was Moses, who was the key to free the Israelites from slavery in Egypt, or whether it was a man named King Cyrus, who freed the Israelites from Babylon. God sends a key person to unlock his people. See, now it works just fine. You know, to unlock his people and to free them. And you know what? We've been freed as well. And our key is who?
God.
Is Jesus, who is God. Yes. Yes. And so Jesus frees us. And how did he free us? How did he unlock us?
With the cross.
When he went and died on the cross, he freed us from all of our sins. He allowed us to live our lives the way God wants us to live. All right, let's fold our hands. Fold your hands. Levi, fold your hands. Fold your hands. Repeat after me. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For freeing me.
For freeing me.
From the chains of sin.
From the chains of sin.
And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. All right, you can go sit down. Apparently I need some oil or something in that lock. We now continue with singing our next hymn.
Peter, chapter 3, verses 8 through 13. But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for the hastening, the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn? But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand and honor the gospel. Our gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 19. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
We now join together in confessing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed, printed on page 6 of your bulletin. When someone asks what you believe, you can respond by saying, "I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." You may be seated as we sing the first two verses of hymn 423, "Jesus, Refuge of the Weary." grace, you in peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this is what the Lord says to his Messiah, to Cyrus. I will go before you and break down the gates of bronze. Isaiah chapter 45, 1, 2. It was the afternoon of August 5th, 2010, when the 120-year-old San Jose copper gold mine in Chile, South America, caved in. 33 men were trapped underneath 2,300 feet of solid rock. 17 days after the accident, a note written in bold red letters appeared, taped to a drill bit when it was pulled up to the surface after penetrating an area believed to be accessible to the trapped workers. It read simply, "We are fine in the shelter, the 33 of us." But they were in survival mode. They ate 2 spoonfuls of tuna, a sip of milk, and a morsel of peaches every other day. They heard the voice that said, "You are locked in with no way out." Now the Chilean miners knew, yes, they knew that. But once the people on the top found out that the men were alive, they spared no effort to rescue them. And soon the skill and knowledge and efforts from around the world converged in Chile. 3 different international drilling rig teams, NASA, and more than a dozen multinational corporations joined together. And after 69 days trapped underground, those 33 men were brought safely to the surface on October 13th, 2010. We know. Yes, we know. Sure, we've been stuck in traffic, stuck in winter, stuck in snow, but that's just on the surface. Deep down, we all know what it is like to also be stuck in the past, stuck in relationships, stuck in a diseased and dying body, stuck in debt, stuck in a dead-end job. Israel likewise knows. Yes, they know. Babylon said, "You are locked in with no way out." In the 6th century BC, God's people were surrounded by bronze gates. Oh, sure, they were also ziggurats and canals, and God's people were also never far away from detestable statues of the Babylonian god Marduk. But it was the gates, and especially the now world-renowned Ishtar Gate, that locked them in with no way out. You see, the Ishtar Gate opened up to a long processional way called Abur Shabu, the enemy shall never pass. The street was then bordered by 120 statues of lions, which were symbols of that goddess Ishtar. And then another 575 figures of dragons or bulls symbolized the Babylonian god Marduk. Babylon, with its hundreds of bronze gates, was the brainchild of Nabopolassar, the founder of the Babylonian Empire, and then his son, the one we're most familiar with, Nebuchadnezzar. In fact, the ancient Greek historians Herodotus and Xenophon both write in the late 7th century and early 6th century that these hundreds and hundreds of bronze gates were erected in and around Babylon, making it the world's most fortified city. Israel was locked in with absolutely no way out. And yet God declared through Isaiah, I will raise up Cyrus in my righteousness. He will set my exiles free. And so Cyrus became God's gate breaker. And so in 539 BC, Cyrus had to go up against the Babylonian Empire and all her gates. And the city began bracing for an all-out battle. The inhabitants stocked their shelves with food and water to prepare for the long siege. And the military got armed up, revved up, psyched up, and then pumped up as they went out the imperial army to go meet Cyrus. Outside of Babylon, the armies met in the field, and Cyrus handily defeated the imperial army and then marched on to finish his conquest of the city itself. The city of Babylon was not only surrounded by bronze gates, but also a series of walls, two of which enclosed this rectangular city. The innermost wall was 21 feet thick, and the outermost wall was 11 feet thick. It had 360 watchtowers on the walls every 60 to 65 feet. And then on top of that, or outside of that actually, a moat-like system in front of that outer wall hindered direct attacks on the wall itself. Babylon was a marvel of architectural planning and construction, the perfect impregnable fortress. And yet, no match for Yahweh. When Cyrus surrounded the city, its citizens, rather than fight to the last man standing in an attempt, an Alamo or Custard's last stand, opened up the gates. And Cyrus simply walked in and took the city with singular ease. All because this was part of God's plan. God's rescue. A rescue that is greater than we imagine and more than we deserve. In fact, Psalm 126 verse 1 says, when the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. That's what Isaiah says throughout his book. When we are stuck in guilt, God promises, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Isaiah 1 verse 18. When we feel buried in gloom and doom, he reminds us, the people walking in darkness have seen a great light. 9 verse 2. When dryness and deadness stand in the way, the Lord turns the deserts into pools of water, and the parched ground into springs. 35 verse 7. When we are surrounded by obstacles, every valley shall be raised up, and every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. 40 verse 4. When blindness and captivity and bondage stand in the way, God's servant comes to open the eyes of the blind, to free the captive from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. 42 verse 7. You know. Yes, you know. You know what it is like for the enemy to lock the gate of your future, to throw away the key. You know what it feels like to be possessed by your past and mired by your malaise and trapped by your transgressions and sins. Paul knew. Yes, Paul knew. As he wrote, I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. Romans 7 verse 23. as he continues, there is so much more I want to say, but I am an unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin, he says in verse 14. I find this law at work. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. Verse 21. That's us. Locked in habits we cannot beat and bound in a bondage that we can't break. Which is why God sent someone greater than Cyrus to rescue us from our prison. Jesus is God's ultimate gate breaker. Opening day was at his baptism, where one witness writes, as he was praying, heaven itself was opened. Spirit empowered, this Messiah ministers in Palestine to open eyes and ears and mouths and hearts. It's like when John the Baptist's disciples came to talk to Jesus. And in that hour, he healed many people of diseases and plagues and evil spirits. And on many who were blind, he bestowed sight. Luke 7, verse 21. And so Jesus goes on to tell them, go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, and the dead are raised up. Yes, he even opens graves. But the grandest opening was still yet to come. After the betrayal, beating, bruising, and even darkening of the sun, Revelation 1 verse 18 makes his victory crystal clear, where he says, I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And behold, I hold the keys of death and Hades. You are no longer locked in with no way out. Because Jesus is God's ultimate gate breaker. Jesus breaks down the gates of guilt and shame and hurt and pain. He breaks down the gates that trap and torture and torment us. And the gates of hell will never prevail against the shed blood, the baptismal power, or the mission of Christ's body, the church. This is how our God rescues. Greater than we imagine, and more than we could ever deserve. If the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We now worship God with our tithes and offering, and as the offering is collected, we will remain sitting. Sorry, when the offering is brought forward, we will stand and sing hymn 423, Jesus, Refuge of the Weary, verse 3. We now join together in the prayer of the church, and we will be saying it responsively as it's printed on page 7 of your bulletin. Lord God, Almighty Father, when guilt stands in our way, you promise. Father, when gloom and doom stand in our way, you say,
the people walking in darkness have seen great light.
Lord, when dryness and deadness stand in our way, you transform
the desert into pools of water and the parched ground into springs.
O God, when huge obstacles stand in our way, you make the solemn pledge.
Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill laid low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places of plain.
And when blindness and captivity and bondage stand in our way, your servant comes to
open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. Your rescue is greater than we imagine, more than we deserve.
O Lord, we believe this promise. If the Son sets us free, you will be free indeed.
Amen.
Boldly and confidently, we pray together the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated as we sing verses 1 through 4 of hymn 644, The Church's One Foundation.
Thank you.
Well, I hope you're feeling a little more freed than you were this morning. Because Christ has risen so that you might know that he has unlocked your chains, that he has broken down those gates of bronze, that he has freed you like he freed his people Israel through that old king named Cyrus. We have several things that I want to point out. One is that if you want to join us for the potluck, you'll notice the fellowship hall is in no state to have a potluck in right now. We've got it kind of deconstructed as we're putting in the flooring for the new entry area of the fellowship hall there. And so we are going to still have the potluck, but we're going to have it downstairs, and we'll just kind of fill all three of those rooms, whatever works. We're all easy, right? And so we're going to do that. And if you would like to help after the potluck, myself and Jimmy and anyone else that wants to join us is going to be putting in more boards. And so we're going to continue putting in boards and continuing to put in that vinyl flooring. And so we're going to do that again tonight and probably stop about 9 o'clock, again tomorrow and stop about 9 o'clock, and again Friday and stop about 9 o'clock, and probably spend most of Saturday on it as well. So it's not hard. It just takes time, right? You have to lock every little board in place. With that, any other announcements? All right. Let us go free.